So okay, I can kick. Thank you, thank you. Hello everyone, my name is Meng. I'm currently a software engineer at GovTech. So today we'll share with you about configuration management with IaC, which is infrastructure as a code. So here's the agenda for today. We'll cover what is infrastructure as code and what is configuration management, followed by why and how. For the how part, we'll compare the popular tools like Ansible, Saltstack, Puppy, and Chef. Then we'll dive into Ansible with an example to show you how the tools can be used. And also we are going to see some Ansible code. Lastly is in the cloud world, there are many managed services. So where does configuration management tool stands? We'll cover that. Okay. So before we start, can I quickly check how many of you have ever used or created a virtual machine before? Can I raise your hand if you have do it? Nice. I saw many, many hands. then any of you has ever do you have experience with configuration management tools like Ansible or Stack? Okay, I saw a few hands. That's good. Okay, so for infrastructure, it's usually referring to the hardware, software, and networking that's required to deliver IT services. For our talk today, we are mainly focused on the environment that's using virtual machines, because for configuration management, it's still mainly to manage the software and the service on the virtual machines or the bare metal servers. Then IaC is actually the process is to provision and manage infrastructure through code instead of manual process. So what does provision and manage of infra actually mean? What does configurations refers to? Then let's take a look at a typical web application. So from here, you can see there are a number of different types of servers, like the web server, app server, and DB server. In order to get your application up and running on this environment, you will require the provisioning, configuration, and deployment process. So in terms of provisioning, is to create the your server, your networking. For server provisioning, you create the virtual machine with the operating system installed on the VM. So at this point, your web server, app server, DB server, they are all still the same because they only have OS installed at the moment. The difference comes when you are doing the configuration stage, where for your web server, you are going to install NGX. Like your application server, you're probably going to require Node.js or Java or Ruby, depends on what your application is written in. Then for your database, you are required to install your database engine and do the configuration and setup. There are also some common services like NTP service, which is to help you to synchronize the time on the server, so that all the servers have the same time, there will not be a different timing. Then for deployment is mainly to get your application code running on the app servers. So hopefully now you get an idea of what creating and manage the infra is about and what configuration of the servers is referred to. So before IaC, things are done manually. Take the configuration, for example. If we want to configure the NTP service, sysadmin will usually need to connect to the server remotely one by one. Then you have to modify the NTP configuration file, restart the NTP service. So it sounds a trivial task, but imagine you have many, many servers to do. And also there are some applications that actually require a lot of configuration. So doing all this in a manual way is just a lot of steps and also error prone. That's why we need to use IaC to automate this process. Then for the configuration management, then we are mainly focusing on the configuration of softwares. So these are the popular infrastructure IaC tools. You can see that things like Puppy, Saltstack, Ansible, CloudFormation, Docker, Kubernetes, blah, blah, blah. So if you are new to all these tools, you may be confused, what are these tools for? So here's how we can categorize the tools. For provisioning tools like Terraform and CloudFormation, it's mainly to help you create cloud resource, such as networking, compute instance storage in the cloud. Then configuration management tools, we have Chef, Puppy, and Ansible, Saltstack to help you manage the required software on servers like virtual machines. Then we also have server templating tools. For Docker is to create container images. Packer and the Vagrant is more on the virtual machine side of template of image. Usually you have your dependence of the application bundled into this image. Last one, we have orchestration tools. They help you to deploy your application. For example, Kubernetes, you can deploy your code into the your code are bundled in the container image, then you deploy the containers. Kubernetes also help you to roll out updates, do some monitoring, auto scaling, and auto healing. In case one container is down, you automatically start another one. So come to the next question. Why do you want to use configuration management tools? Well, first of all, it will help you to automate the manual process. Imagine you have to configure 10 servers or 100 servers that require the same setup. Doing this in a manual way is just repetitive work and also boring and also error prone. So with the configuration code that's ready to use, you are able to deploy and set up a new server in a much faster, more reliable way. And it's also more scalable because you can just do everything in a very fast and persistent way. So the versioning will also help to track what change has been made and when. It also enforces certain coding conventions, these tools, compared with ad hoc scripts. So the code will be quite easy to understand and maintain. Lastly, the knowledge is also preserved in code because configuration management tools usually are quite readable. So they can serve as a documentation for how your server can be configured and should be configured. So another benefit of these tools is that they can help reduce configuration drift. Configuration drift is over the time when you apply more and more changes on the server. So since the server can become slightly different, especially when you are doing things manually. So this will lead to subtle configuration bugs that's very hard to diagnose and or reproduce. So these tools can help reduce the drift because everything is managed by code. Then no server should be different if they are only applied by code, only configured by code. So now let's take a look at the configuration management tools. Ansible, Saltstack, Puppy, and Chef, these are the popular tools currently. They are all open source, and they have been around for more than 10 years. So they are all quite mature and provide rich features. Also, they are still actively being maintained and developed. In terms of the difference, look at the configuration language and management. For Ansible and Saltstack, the tools themselves are written in Python, and the configuration language is actually just YAML, so it's quite easy to understand and to get started. Then for Puppy and Chef, they are written in Ruby, and to get started with the configuration, you actually need to learn some of you have to learn their own domain-specific language that will make it a little, it's more difficult to get started. In terms of setup, Ansible will be very, very easy because it has a client-only architecture. For example, I can use my laptop as a management Ansible management node. I just need to do brew install Ansible. Then I can get started and start to write the configuration code. For Saltstack, Puppy, and Chef, they are using the server and client architecture. That means you have to configure both the server and the clients. So more stuff to configure and set up. You also need to ensure the communication between the server and the client are there to set up properly. Okay, so let's take a further look at the architecture. For the server client architecture, that we have Salt, Puppy, and Chef. Then Ansible is the client only. So in terms of setup and management, we talked about just now. So how do they work? For the server client architecture, normally the server has the latest version of the configuration code. Then the clients will frequently call the server and get updated version of the code on themselves, and then they will apply the changes by themselves. Then for client only like Ansible, usually your configuration code will be only available on the management node. And when you want to apply the changes, the changes are pushed to the server, to the clients, and the commands are executed remotely on these agents. Then we have the push and the pull, which are the different models, different ways to deploy the configuration changes. As you can see, they're actually quite closely related with the architecture. For example, like Ansible, there's no server, so the only way will be push. You have to, the configuration call is on the management node, then you push the change over. Then for, so Saltstack is also a little bit special. It's because for Saltstack, they allow the Salt master to push the hook scripts to their clients. That's why it can also do push, but it's still meaning a pull model. So all the agents actually try to fetch the code from the master and from time to time, and then they're going to apply the change on the clients. So for the push style, it's simple to manage and set up, but it may not scale very well when there are thousands plus servers, because they all rely on one single master server and is doing the connection concurrently for all the agents together. And also in a distributed environment, when the network is not very stable, error handling or there's no retry mechanism can be difficult. For the pull model, so it will require more setup and management, but it will scale well because the agents will periodic to contact the master and get the change. In case of failures, you automatically retry and apply the changes. But the additional setup could be just more effort. And also you have to make sure that the agents, the daemons on your client is running all the time, else your code could be outdated. Okay, so which tool to use? Well, there are pros and cons in each of the tools we discussed just now. So it depends on what's the the scenario that you are using. So for example, if you are using IoT device, there could be many devices, and then the network connection could be unstable between the devices. So the push model might not be that good. So you probably want to choose pull model instead. Then choose and switch wisely. For example, you are already using tools like Puppy. Then you probably don't need to change to another one just because the tool may sound more modern or cool. The last one is just to try out, get the feeling of the tools. So no matter which tools that you choose, just follow this best practice. We should treat our infra code the same way as our application code. So we want to do version control, we want to make small changes and do code review, and don't put everything into one single file, big file. So break them down into small and reusable modules. Then in terms of testing, infra code is usually harder to test compared with application code, because it's really difficult to do unit test for infra code. So the list will be test your infra code in lower environment before they go to production. Last one is change of behavior. So this is actually quite important, especially if your team is currently used to the way of doing things manually. So you need to everyone in the team to get into this idea of using this tool. Say if anyone is not decide to go to do things manually and make change ad hoc on the server, then the next time when you deploy your configuration code, the code will fail. And slowly people won't trust your code. And then people will revert back to the old way of doing things manually. Okay, now let's come to Ansible. So we'll show you a demo in a screen recording later to configure NGX to host the static website. So this is the setup I have. I have three EC2 servers. So the setup is in AWS. I have three EC2, which are the virtual machines in AWS. And they are all behind a load balancer. This load balancer is public facing, and it has this DNS name. So once everything is configured properly, we can go to the browser and hit this URL. So this Ansible management node is actually my laptop. So it can reach to the EC2's via SSH. And these are the two files, Ansible code. The first one is the host inventory, which basically tell Ansible how to connect to the host. What are the hosts that I want to connect to? And then the other one is the playbook. So this playbook will tell Ansible to do a number of stuff to how to configure the servers. Okay. Before the demo, let's quickly see the manual way first. If I'm to do this manually from my laptop, I will need to SSH into each server by one, and then install, for example, the NGX RPM. Then also create some required directory on the server to host my website files. Then also need to make additional configuration change on the NGX config file, restart the service, and etc. So doing one server manually is okay. Three is repetitive. Imagine I need to do more. Or imagine that I need to do this again after some time, maybe 1 week or 2 weeks. I won't be able to remember all the details. So with Ansible, we are able to do all this configuration with a few commands. Yeah. Okay. So just now was I to show you that the EC2, the virtual machine is up and running, but when I try to hit the URL, it doesn't give anything because the server is still just, there's nothing on the server yet. Okay. So now I come to the code. Is to run the Ansible command with this playbook called web servers. And you will do some basic stuff like install NGX, then create the directories. So notice now this is changed, but if I run the same command again, you will show OK instead of change, because the change is already there. There's no need to apply the change again. Okay. So this is a second playbook, which is to copy the static websites over to the remote server. So now I come back to this URL in the browser. You can see the website is up and running. Okay. And come back to the, this is the target group in AWS. So you can see the status changed to healthy now. Okay, you cannot see. Wait, I need to go to the next page. Okay, so here's the directory layout for the Ansible code in the demo just now. So usually we have an Ansible folder. Inside it will have all the Ansible code that you require. There are playbooks like web servers, the YAML, sync the YAML. That's where you define the task that you want to do. Then some important directory will be the inventory file. That's where we put the host IP or the host DNS name inside. Then another one is the files. You can see there's a cloning.conf. This cloning service is just it's just an NTP service, but that's for Red Hat 7 and 8. Then there is also a template. So the difference between files and templates is one is a static configuration file, while the templates one can interpret some variables inside. So make this one dynamic. We'll cover more later. So just now in the demo, I just need to go to the Ansible directory and run these commands. So Ansible playbook -- inventory is to tell Ansible where the inventory file is. So it's under inventory host file. Then the last one will be the playbook. So this one will be a shorter form of the inventory. It's -i instead of inventory. Okay. So more on the inventory file. This is how we can group the servers together. So say now we have a web servers. I put the DNS name of these web servers, but they can all just be IP address. So it can be like 132.2.1.4, etc. Basically, it's tell Ansible how to reach out to these servers. Then below is the variables that we define for this specific group of servers. You can see there's a domain, which is the DNS name that for the load balancer that we saw just now. You'll see this value can be accessed in playbook level and template later. Then we also have this Ansible user and Ansible SSH private key file variables. So these variables are defined over there so that I can just run the command like this without passing through all these values inside here. So the -u is to specify which SSH user I'm using, and this is where the SSH private key locates. So a little bit further is that you can also, this is for web servers, you can also define like database servers with another set of IP and their own variables. So now we come to the playbook. The playbook is Ansible to use to tell what to do. Basically, you will start with a name. It's a description of what this playbook is about. And then the host, here we put a web server, is according to the inventory file here. And then become yes. This is normally required because during SSH, usually you cannot use root user to SSH to the remote server. But when you run the task, you actually need the root privilege. That's why you have to become yes. Then is the task. So for task, here has two tasks. Each of them will have a name. This name is also is optional, but good to have to tell what this is about, what it want to do. Then inside each task, you have the modules. For example, here, the module will be the YAML module, and then the second one will be file module. So whatever that's behind the module are the arguments that you pass in for this module. So for the first one, it's actually tell Ansible to do the YAML install, which is to install the package NGX, and then the state specify is the latest version. Then for this file, then for this file module, it's actually to create the required directories inside this directory. So here you can see there is a domain that's enclosed by the double curly braces. There are the value that's defined in the inventory file here. So you can access this value directly inside here. Then this with item is like the for loop in Ansible. So Ansible will loop through all this stuff and replace the item value with the one below. So there are some common tasks like copy the configuration file from your local to the remote server. This is one example that how we set up the NTP configuration, copy the configuration file over. So the source is crony.conf, and if you look at the folder directory, you'll be under the files directory, then there's a crony.conf. What's inside this crony.conf is just these lines, which actually the Singapore public NTP servers and plus some more lines. What this task will do is you'll copy this file from my laptop to a remote server, and the destination will be the etc crony.conf, and also it will help to set up the owner and the permission for this file. So just now, the copy module is only able to copy files, static configuration files. If you want to make the configuration files dynamic, then we will need to use this template module. And also, Ansible is using Jinja 2 templating. So how it will look like is that the variables are enclosed with these double curly braces, and this domain variable is defined in your host file, inventory file that you saw just now. So the file directory will be like this. There is a template folder, then the template. Also need to know that normally for the Jinja template, you have to have this .j2 postfix. Okay. So this is the last bit of Ansible code that we're going to see, which is the handlers. If you look at the example here for handlers, it's after we copy the NGX configuration file, then there is a notify restart NGX, which is defined here. So what it does is we'll restart the NGX service only when there's a changes to the NGX configuration file. So if there's no change, then the NGX service will not be restarted. Okay, so in the previous demo, the task handlers are all put inside this web server YAML display book. So now we want to organize this differently so we can create something called roles. For example, you can have a common role, then you can put, with this common role, we can set up the NTP services. So you can put the task related to NTP into this task folder on the main.yaml. Then you can restart your NTP service. That handler can go inside handler folder. So in this way, your playbooks now will look like this. You have host, then you define the roles. It's common and the web tier specific stuff. In this way, you can reuse this common role, for example, for DB servers or other type of servers. Okay, then for the multi-environment directory layout, is beside the inventory folder, you can create more folders like production folder, staging folder. That's where you can put your host file in. And they probably will have different variables defined as well. Then the playbook will inside here, and you also have the roles. So in terms of the master playbook, you have become like this. You can import the web server's playbook and DB server playbook. And inside the web servers, you have common role and the web tier roles. With this structure, you are able to run the playbook in this way. So this one will deploy everything into production, and this one will deploy production, but we just limit to web servers. The configuration change will not go to like DB servers. This is also the same. So for configuration code, usually we want to them have the same set of code, but it's just between environments, it's just the variables that changes. Okay, so a bit more info on Ansible. That is Ansible Tower. This is the enterprise version of Ansible. It provides features like graphic user interface, dashboard, and also the role-based access and control, job scheduling, etc., etc. But it's an enterprise version, so I have to pay for this license. Then, there's also Ansible Galaxy. So it is a large public repo of Ansible roles. And normally with the remix, they will have details about how you can use the roles. But I would say because each environment setup can be different, so you probably just use them as a reference instead of just copy and blindly apply to your environment, because you may not need everything. Okay, come to the last part for the cloud world. Previously, for the application deploy on the virtual machine, we need to do provision and configuration and deployment. So now in the cloud world, together with the usage of containers, you do not need to configure things like NTP service, NGX, Node.js, etc., because they are already bundled into your Docker images. And in terms of deployed Docker images to containers, you probably don't want to create the EC2 instance and start to set up your own Kubernetes cluster or manage your own Docker nodes. You are more likely to use the managed service like such as ECS or EKS. Then same for the database part. Since there are managed service like RDS, you don't need to create a virtual machine and then install the DB engine yourself anymore. Hence, there are much less required need for configuration management tools. Okay, so is configuration management going to be dead? No. Although there will be required less as the need will decrease, but not all the softwares are suitable to run in containers or running in serverless. And also software as a service or software or infra as a service is just someone else's servers. So someone still needs to manage the service. Okay, summary. What's IaC and the configuration management tools? IaC is to manage and provision infra to code. Then configuration management to install, set up, manage the software on the servers. So why it is important? It's faster, more reliable, and more scalable to use them. Also help to reduce the configuration drift. And how? We cover we do a comparison between the popular tools, and also we look at example of Ansible with inventory, playbook, and role, etc. So in the cloud world, configuration management won't be dead. That's all for my talk.
Understand.
Customer ways.
Speaking of orchestration, I have feeling that Ansible and Saltstack actually was invented exactly as orchestration was first, and then after some success, they decided to put configuration management there as well because they can. And in Ansible, it's less visible. In Saltstack, it's visible much. So if you look into Saltstack, you can understand that it was invented like just okay, we need this, let's do this shortcut to do this. At least this is my point of view based on my experience. Then and the last part of the talk about cloud configuration, you should mention immutable infra, which is actually just containers, and you can use virtual machines in two ways. First one, which most of us I guess doing, mm-hmm. is we are using them as usual servers. Mm-hmm. Like, okay, there is a server with some life cycle, and usually it will stay there until we don't need it anymore, or we need to upgrade it, or whatever. Mm-hmm. If you're using virtual machines in, I guess it was original intention of virtual machine, so you can create it, you can put something there, and if you need to do any change, mm-hmm. it depends on how big the change is, but mm-hmm. You can